It's great to have Gabe Rodriguez here with us. Gabe's an alumnus of Eastern and has gone on as a composer and as a studio musician. It's great to have him here, share some of his most recent work and projects, and let's have a word of prayer together. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this day, for the opportunity to learn and grow. Thank you for this new semester. We dedicate it to you and pray that you will help us to be fresh and fervent and renewed by our community and by your spirit. We also pray for the life and energy that comes from your word. And so I pray that as we start this semester, we will start in the fullness of our dedication to knowing your word in flesh and your word in scripture. And thank you for this opportunity now to experience your work of grace in Gabriel's life. Bless him. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Gabriel Rodriguez.
So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk a little bit about the show, the understanding of director's vision, my responsibilities and the team I worked with, and my process with making the music and some other things and some examples. So this is the cast of the show, Single and Anxious. This was the show I composed music to. So you have Malaya Gregory, Brandon Brooke, Paige Wilson, Darina Sophia, Fan Sanders, and Don Cephas. All right, so about the show. I would give a little brief description of it, but since our director of the show is here, if you could come up and just share a little bit of the show and what it's about.
Hey guys, how you guys doing? I'm Christina Faith. The show is called Single and Anxious. It's about five college students who are caught between love, crime, and relationships. So the premise of the show is just to see what it looks like for college students to live kind of like double lives in a sense, yet to have relationships with their friends and feel like they know each other, but they don't.
Communication is key. You'll probably see that throughout the entire presentation. You know, what type of music do they like? Really, you can do that by studying the type of music they listen to, whether it's funk, hip-hop, orchestral, classical, anything. For this particular purpose, she really wanted some hip-hop elements, so I used that, but I had to really see what she liked. You know, what musical emotion she wanted in each scene. So I'm always following up with that as well. So I'll start a project, and I won't really get too far into it without sending it to her. So I'll do like maybe a reference or a draft, and I'll email it. Hey, how does it sound? For the most part, she liked, you know, everything I did. Some parts, you know, she wanted to take out and put other stuff in. So I made sure that I was really aware of, you know, that communication. One thing that really helped me with the show was reading the script and also understanding the script. So for this show, I spent more time listening and watching the show to actually understand what the script was. And aside from understanding the director's vision, it's really understanding the director. Everybody's different. So, you know, communication, again, is key. And find out how they communicate. You know, if you're a phone guy or a phone person, but the director emails all the time, like, you're going to have to email a lot. And save your emails. You know, even if it's a okay, thanks, like save it. You just never know, because it might have been an attachment of something I need to read or anything in that matter. So, and my responsibilities. So my first thing was watching all the footage as is. Like, I'm not thinking anything musically. I can put the piano and drum machine to the side. I just wanted to watch the whole show, the first season, as is. And then just keep understanding what's going on, the different angles, even though there were different versions of what she sent me in terms of video, it's always good to just watch it. And the next thing is, for me, I had to find what my creative flow was. And if this was my first this obviously wasn't my first music project, so I kind of have an understanding of what my flow and my creative flow is. So once I found that, I had to live in it. There's really, for me, you know, I can't turn my creative side on and off. Like, it's just, it has to be throughout, it has to be consistent. And so what that really means is, you know, I work front desk at a hotel, and I'm, you know, front desk clerk, and I check people in, check them out, I do the banking and everything. But when I have breaks, which is like probably 80% of my shift, you know, God has given me the gift to be patient, but also use my musical gifts. So I'll bring my laptop, I'll, you know, watch the show, keep watching, and there's like a little keyboard function here where I can make music. I'm not gonna bring my keyboard to work, obviously, but I can make beats there. But if I'm not making beats, I'll beatbox. So I'm always beatboxing. I try not to do it in front of the guests, but sometimes my bosses are, anyway. And give yourself deadlines. You know, I really had to give myself deadlines. You know, Christina, you know, she would say, hey, you know, let's have this music done by the 20th. I made sure I got it done by the 10th, because you just never know what changes they want. You know, I'll send it 10 or 5 days at the most in advance. I'll send it, hey, how's the sound? What does this look like? Do you want me to put this in there? Take this out? And I really use these deadlines for myself, but also for the team that worked under me. I had about two or three people. To start with, I had about two musicians that I worked with. So there were, this is a web series, so it's not like 30 minutes an episode. It's very short, so like 10 minutes. But that's 10 minutes of music. So there were three of us. I gave the first person two episodes, I gave the next person two, and I gave myself two. I didn't just throw them out there, I tried to see what fit their genre best. So I worked with them, and unfortunately it didn't work out the way I planned it to. We were 2 weeks in, you know, I was getting my music done. I kind of had to take a pause because I was doing a lot of meetings and with the team. We couldn't meet in person, but thank God for technology. We use Google Hangouts or Skype, whatever you need to use, FaceTime, anything. So we were communicating through there, and I was, you know, I gave them specific instructions, and it just went out one ear and went out the other. So it was kind of weird. So we were about a month in the project, and I said, hey, you know, you said everything's good. You told me you had a person coming in to record vocals or something. How's it going? Can I hear what you have? Oh, I didn't even start yet. I'm like, are you serious? Like, it's a month. So this is an example of procrastination. This video clip, I had a, I'm not going to say, we're going to call her, we're not going to call her anything. I don't want to say her name by accident. So she had two episodes. She barely finished one. She did about eight measures for 10 minutes. And here's an example.
Marissa. Marissa, come here.
What?
Am I annoying you?
You rain while you scream.
Wait for the drop.
What you think about this necklace with this outfit?
Why do you do this? You ask me what I think and then end up changing it completely.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
Okay, that's enough of that. Yeah, so that, you can understand my frustration. You know, it wasn't the fact that I needed help with the show musically, but the director and I wanted to give other musicians a chance. We wanted to give them, you know, we carefully chose different genres. So one person was like funk, and this other guy was like hip hop, and I was basically the person to do like the orchestration, so the string writing, brass. We didn't focus too much on that, but whenever it was needed, we did that, and also like the overall mix of the song, and just filling whatever gaps were necessary. That's what I was gonna do, but. Say all that to say I had to do the entire season. I was so overwhelmed that Christina had to find another person that was free that actually did the first episode and the last episode. Everything else in between I basically did everything, but I was in charge of like episode 2 through 5. And yeah, so long story short, all the music's done. You know, I was at this place where I'm like, great, you know, I can relax. Tiffany, who is my girlfriend, I'm like, we're going to the beach, we're gonna go in the water, and we're just gonna be, we're gonna have fun. Towards the end of our trip, we're about to pack up, and I get a text message from Christina with about someone else in the other department, which was, first we have music, department, we have the audio, you know, mixing and mastering, and then we had obviously cinematography, lighting. So the audio engineer, I get a text message saying he quit. We can't do anything else, so you know, we need to figure out what we're gonna do. And being the person that I am, I said, look, I'll do it. I'll do all the audio. So this next slide is basically what the second process was for me, which is ADR. So ADR is automated dialogue replacement. So definition, I'll just read it off the screen. The process of re-recording dialogue by the original actor after the filming process to improve audio quality. So we spent countless hours in the studio looking at different scenes that were recorded, not badly recorded. Well, some of it was, but for the most, she knows what I'm talking about. But for the most part, it's just stuff we couldn't avoid. Like we were outside, we had this beautiful shot, but there was noise. We didn't have enough money in our budget to block off, you know, certain stores or blocks, streets. So we just had to film right there raw, and we come back in the studio and re-record all the audio, the dialogue, the sound effects. Obviously putting the music under it, and it took a long process, but I'll show you an example. First you'll see the reference track, the next slide the next clip will be dialogue, the next you'll see it separately, so I'm not just going to throw it out. You'll see that, and then the sound effects, the music, and then everything together. So here you go.
I want to know one thing. Why was T Super acting like that the other day at Jimmy?
I don't know, it was awkward, right?
Yo.
You know, it just takes them a while to remember people, new people, and then.
I want to know one thing.
What?
Why was T treating Sebastian like that the other day at Jimmy's?
I know, it was awkward, right?
Yo.
It just takes them a while to warm up to people, new people at that.
I want to know one thing.
What?
Why was T treating Sebastian like that the other day at Jimmy's?
I know, it was awkward, right?
Yo.
It just takes them a while to warm up to people, new people at that.
We did so much ADR for this show, it should have been a cartoon. Like, we did way too much. You know, even during the sets where we had a quiet room, the boom mic on the vocals, on the actors, and it was still badly recorded. It was, you know, we were dealing with people that had experience, but most of it was just one big lie. It was sad. I was almost pulled my hair out. And we spent you know, with the person that was starting the process of recording audio, he quit, so then he gave us a hard drive, and it's like he took a bag of marbles and just opened it and said, here. And I had to pick everything up. There was stuff we didn't know where it was. Christine and I, she went to my job to look at, like, she put stuff on my hard drive, she put stuff on her hard drive, and we were just trying to figure out what stuff he kept, what stuff we didn't use. There was, like, you know, for one scene, it was, I'd say, about 100 tracks, 10 tracks of the same exact stuff. So we were just trying to figure out what the heck did he do. And then once we finally organized it, we still couldn't use it. We had to go into another location and schedule another meeting to record all of this stuff. Let's actually watch the trailer.
As your father, I am trying to protect you.
No, you're trying to control me.
And you think that he isn't?
Maya don't deserve nothing like that. Don't make her a part of your juggling act.
Don't ever leave me, Rissy.
So I have, when I score music, I have the video on one screen and the project on this screen. So this is the project of the trailer. So if I open up the video, I'll probably, you know, check that to the side. I can make it as small as I want, big as I want. I was using this way of scoring, but I really needed to get a second monitor because you can only use that small thing for but so long. The music to this trailer was very simple. As you can see, I don't have that many tracks, maybe like 18. I have piano, I have some other sound effects. That pulsating sound you heard in the trailer, what is it, right? Not that. Here it is. That noise. You hear that a lot of times in, like, Marvel movies. Some very, very basic orchestral with the constant. That was actually brass. So I took French horns and trombones and I basically distorted them. So this is without the distortion. And you see I had to turn it up because distortion makes it extremely loud. So I'm gonna turn that back down and bring it back up. So, boom. So that's the French horn. And this one gives it a little more high end. And then together, when you play it.
As your father, I am trying to protect you.
No, you're trying to control me.
And you think that he isn't?
So yeah. Then I didn't really have a tempo reference or time signature because the heartbeat was really the driving force, which is right here. So it kind of sounds like 3, 4, 6, 8, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, like that. And I didn't want to quantize a heartbeat because you can't do that to a heartbeat, unless you're a robot. So I made sure, you know, see the tempo is 120. Obviously, I'm not following that.
As your father, I am trying to...
So I just kind of had to bend the rules. And you'll have to do that as a composer a lot. So let's get into the next project, which is episode 2.
Before you leave that, can you talk a little bit about the relationship between 120 and what you did? Like, why you chose not to observe that?
Basically, I didn't even pay attention to the BPM, which is beats per minute. I really ignored it. I was fishing for different heartbeat sounds. Ideally, I wanted to record my own heartbeat, but I don't have the technology for that. And plus, it would be like a little fun fact for oh, look what Gabe did. So I just found different heartbeat sound effects, and others were either not recorded right. This one had that punch, and as you can see, I tried to put some EQ on it, which would have made it very, 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 very bassy, but that just wasn't working. So I'm like, let me just work with this, and just work with the mastering after that. So yeah, that's really what I did. I didn't spend too much time on the tempo, but however I did in the other spots of each episode. So let's get into an episode since we're talking about that. So this does take a little bit to low. So do you guys have any questions so far at all? Anybody? Yeah.
How did you learn to do all this?
John Greenland. I wish he was here to watch this. I really was. I'm trying not to get emotional. But sorry. Yep. He was the man when it came to electronic music. I didn't expect to be crying right now.
Gabe, do you have equipment for when you sample and record?
Sample and record. Let me see. Like, if I find something online.
Yeah, find something you like and pull it over.
Yeah, so if there's really no rights to certain pieces, like the heartbeat, I mean, you can just get that offline. A lot of people upload stuff on YouTube. There's no rights, it's just sound, and you can just rip it off. So you can go to like YouTube to MP3. And if you don't want to deal with like the compression of MP3, Wave, AIFF, you can go to keepvid.com, and then you can go there and just take the video off and then split the audio and the video. So you can throw the video out, put the audio in there. So that's basically what I did.
Hey, can you speak to how long it takes to pick sounds and design sounds?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So when it comes to sounds, like, you know, I'll just throw a piano track. If just for, you know, the skeleton of the whole project, I'll write that way and go back to it later. But really, it's, you know, Logic, this is actually the program I'm using. And this, there's endless sounds in this entire project. Let's close this video out. So this is actually a drum machine that I came up with. I actually made the arrangement of it. So if I'm, let me open
Gabe,
the project.
Gabe, how long did it take you to make the drum kit?
Oh, the drum kit? Well, I made the drum kits like before I even started the show. This was just stuff I enjoyed doing on my own. So, like, these are different tracks I use. Those are different drum tracks there, but obviously I know where they all are because you can program each and every pad. And then I'll have that going. Then you got the, you know, different synths there. This is Alchemy. This is a synthesizer. And you can literally go in to the advanced and you can mess with the WAV file, you can mess with the attack, the hold, everything.
How did you get connected with the project?
Yeah, so I knew Christina for about 10 years almost. We went to the same church, and I transitioned to another church about a year and a half later after I transitioned. Christina messaged me on Facebook, and she said, hey, we need some extras to be in the show. Do you know anybody at Eastern? And I'm like, I mean, not really. I don't know. But if you want me to show up, I'll show up. So I showed up there. I was going to be an extra. But she didn't like the shirt I had on, so couldn't be in it. I can be honest, that shirt was a little too tight. But so yeah, we
you were in it. You were behind the piano.
Yeah, you didn't see the shirt though. It was hidden. But anyway, we were doing one of the scenes. It was a break time, so I went into the chapel. We were filming in the Baird Library. So I went in the chapel, and I started playing. You know, it's a piano there. I'm going to play it. So I was playing it, and she just got inspired right there and said, we need you to do, like, the score to the show. Can you do it? I'm like, of course I can do it. In my head, I'm like, how am I going to do this? Because I never did anything like this before, except for, like, different projects with John Greenland. You know, but they were like short clips of like movies, like maybe 30 seconds or a minute, but not a whole show. This is like an hour worth of music. So it was definitely different for me. So this is a project of season 2. So if I zoom out of it, you can kind of see different tracks. They fall into different places. Let's just play a little bit of it and then I'll kind of break it down. Before I did the music, I looked at this entire scene right here. You know, they're at an ice cream shop. It's, you know, almost, it's early evening. It's just two girls having fun. They're talking. And I told myself, like, what type of music should I put in there? And I came up, I was like, okay, let me start out with strings. So came up with that. Usually when I score, I don't already have the chords in my head. I'll literally just be banging on this keyboard until something comes out. I try to put theory aside, and then there's always a place to come back to it. So once, you know, I'll throw in, you know, these chords. So I'm like, okay, let me try that. So then that's when, you know, you come in with the strings right here. And then each track here are drum tracks, and they're all there. So that hi-hat right there is really just a simple hi-hat. But I threw some effects on it, so it sounded kind of like a waterfall. So, compliments John Greenland again. Sorry. So, yeah. He really taught me to explore different sounds, like dissect them. Where did it come from? You know, you can always go into the finder, which is at the bottom left, and just figure out, like, okay, what's the name of the sound? I'm going to look for it. I'm going to cut it up in the pieces and put it back together. Like, you have to really get involved into the sound. So you know where it comes from. You know how it works. So this is just, like, a very simple effect you can put on there. And then you have, that's muted. Do, 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 do. So yeah, and then it all comes together. So that's all the drums right there. And they all serve a purpose. The next scene, well, kind of the next scene, of this female right here that just walked up. I'll just play it for you. But you see she's walking up. And I'm like, okay, do I want to keep the music or change it to something else? Originally, I kept the same music going and just kind of took all the instruments out and brought them back in once they hugged right there. But Christina said, well, I kind of want something else. So I'm like, okay, you're taking me out of my comfort zone here. So so I then looked at this next synth, and it took me probably 30 minutes to find this synth, and I really like it. It's kind of wavy. I didn't want to use, like, hold the note out, but if you just play it, I'm like, oh, okay, sounds good. So it's hip hop. She loves hip hop. So then I threw some drums on it, and it sounds like this. So you see her just walking. I'm like, okay, this is her swag right here. So that's basically that conversation right there. Because she's very, I mean, I wouldn't say ghetto, but she's very like, you know, okay, we're going to say ghetto. You know, she, and that's like her theme right there is what I'm trying to say. And then also the transition. So it'll come from here into like a shot of Eastern, which I just didn't want it to be blank. So I threw some keys on there. So I'm muting the reference because you won't even be able to hear what was going on anyway, because this is just a music project. I have other spots where I have multiple projects. So I have music, I have ADR, and then the final mix. So you can't. I didn't want to put too much on each project because it'll keep giving out on me, and I have to hope that it doesn't do it again and keep recording, but it was throwing me off. So I'm like, okay, let me separate these tracks. So yeah, I have that. And then this was the other spot of music. I put into a folder so you can see the different tracks here. But also it helps me to stay organized. So I'll have, you know, this whole project here, but once I open it up, you can see more stuff, so I can focus on certain things at a time. Yeah, so I'll just play this track here.
Rissa, come here.
What?
Am I annoying you?
You rain, well, you scream.
What do you think about this necklace with this outfit?
So this is very quirky, you know, like they're just sarcastic with each other. They're trying to talk about just some basic stuff, like how do I look, are you trying to impress this boy, you know? So I wanted to bring in some element that was very free, you know. You'll hear different instruments come in at a time once when they talk about certain things. See, like the triangle there.
He's not trying to be your brother.
No, but I'm not feeling him like that. He is too perfect.
So yeah, that's that right there. And I'll bring in also another track, episode 3. As you can see, the drum machine, the beatboxing I was doing, and then when it came into an actual instrumental, I'll show you where I used that. So episode 3, there's a shot of a person sitting on the car, but then there's a car coming up. And that music, I mixed it in a way that it sounded like it was coming from the car. So I'll play it for you. What you heard right when the shot came in, you heard it kind of going away. Really, I've worked with like the filtering, so you can mess with the EQ equalization of the high frequency, mid, and low. So I took some of that away and kept the low frequency, and that's when you see the car, and it sounds like it's coming from the car. So that's basically what a lot of, not composers, sometimes a composer will give that element, But really the engineering process is what kind of makes that what it is. This last one I'm going to show is of music that we didn't use, but it was from a different musician that sent me all the audio files, and we really didn't know where the music fit because everything was like totally different. You had different time signatures, stuff was just everywhere. So I'll show you what I did to kind of dissect each and every music piece. So as you see the time signatures are different and the tempos are different too. I didn't want to just throw music on there. I wanted to separate, like have it its own thing. This is 7/8, then it goes into 4/8, and then 1/4 back to 4/4 because of the way the shots looked. So this was one shot, and if I move it, you'll see it goes into another shot. And then it didn't have enough time to finish the 4/4, so I did 1/4 and back to 4/4 because the music had to change. And then back here, I put it into 10/16 in order for it to go back into 6/8. So it's just a lot going on there, but I'll just play it for you. And then 10/16. And that's throughout everything. Like, this is the entire project, all 10 minutes. 4/4, 6/8, all everything. So, crazy. And we didn't use it. We didn't use any of this music.
I don't remember it.
Yeah. So, yeah, given that, like, there's so much music you're going to use, but a lot of it, you have to, as a composer, you have to humble yourself and say, okay, we can't use that. Okay, let's go into something else. So, and even as the engineer, which I wish I wasn't, because I made all this music and then we had a screening, just me and her, of like mixing it down. And there was plenty of times of turn the music down. And I'm like, oh, you're killing me. So there was so much of that. But once you saw the finished product, it made more sense. So I'm like, okay, there it is. So whenever I think it sounds good, I have to tell myself, turn it down about 5 decibels, always by default. And I just got better at it and better at it. And she said, okay, boom, we're good.
How long did it take you to do all that?
This took me, I'd say about 3 months. Everything from start to finish, including the people that quit, the people that gave me weird stuff that wasn't finished at all, about 3 months. If this was just me doing the music, I would have finished the music in probably like 2-3 weeks, because they're really short episodes. This really isn't hard. Like, you really just have to understand your creative flow, like we spoke about earlier. Get in that. Constantly just make stuff. Don't ever say, I'm making this for episode 4. Just make music. And the more you make music, you'll just have stuff. Hey, how does it sound? Or what's that sound like? You want to use that? Want to use that? There was tracks I made 2 years ago that I put in the show because I just make music. The audio process, if everything, in a perfect world, if I started everything, if I started session 1, and finished, that would have probably taken me about 2-3 weeks. Because it's really just understanding the angle. And I really enjoy people. I love talking to people, understanding people. So with that, it's easy for me to just adapt. And I learned that even here, at Eastern. Just understanding, schedules are going to change. But always, always have a plan B, C, D, all the way through Z. Even my senior recital, I had some people that couldn't make it to the actual jury, but I said, okay, I need to make 3 versions of the song just in case somebody gets sick or someone string pops. And I presented it. Hey, I have this song. I have it three ways. How do you want me to do it? I can sing it. I have it backed up in the track. This string player couldn't show up, so I'm pressing a button. Her track's right there. How do you want this? And they said, do it the best way you want to do it. So I hit the track. I had 3 out of 5 string players, but everything was so perfectly in tune that it was like, if you close your eyes, it's like everyone was there. So like I said, always have a plan, and communicate. Because if you do projects, and there's no communication, as musicians, it's really, really, really hard to find a musician that is on time, that knows their stuff. I mean, we all did orchestra at one point, or some other ensemble. If orchestra is at 6:30, what time do you have to be there? Exactly, 6 o'clock, 6:15. Why? So you can practice, right? So you can warm up. That's, you know, life. If I have work, I show up, you know, 5-10 minutes early, because I have to clock in to be there. You know, I'm not gonna clock in and say, okay, I'm gonna go to the bathroom, then I'm gonna eat something. Like, I'm supposed to be at work. So that's anything. In regards to here, just always be prompt, always be on time, communicate, find out how the director communicates so that you can communicate the best way you can. And with all that, I can say thanks for being here. And I can take any other questions if you do have them. But thank you so much.